Hello children, again I welcome you all to my session. I hope all of you are doing well, and today we are going to start with a new story, that is Quality. It is there in your first term examination, and we are going to start with it today. First of all children, before starting with the original story, I would like to tell you all that in this world nowadays, the story deals with the concept of excellence. The story is basically concerned with a particular individual's excellence in his or her trade, in his or her business. In this world, in today's world children, most of us are hardly bothered, are hardly careful about excellence. In this world, we are at present focused on mass production. That is, according to us, the need of the hour. That is produce in bulk, and we have no place for excellence in our life. Like, we don't pay much attention towards values and work ethics when it comes to producing or giving something. But in this story, we will come across the fact how two brothers had spent their entire life in striving for excellence, and they never compromised with the material that they used while preparing shoes. And they were shoemakers, the two brothers, that is Gessler brothers in the story. They are shoemakers, and in the story we will come across the fact that those two brothers, they strive for excellence and high quality products in this market of competition, and you can say brand tag being attached to each and every article being manufactured these days. These two brothers, they strive for excellence and perfection in whatever they did. They never compromised with the products, the material they used in preparing the shoes. That is, you can say that they had some high values in their life regarding their profession. They never compromised with that, and though they were not very rich, they were not able to earn more, because if we strive for excellence, if we strive for perfection, then it is very obvious, children, that we cannot achieve it within seconds. It takes time, it is a time-taking effort, and we gradually achieve perfection. If we want to do something in a very excellent manner, we cannot do it within a blink of an eye. No, it is not the fact. It requires enormous amount of effort from our side, and it requires time also. We cannot do it within seconds. We cannot do it without putting in hard work. But these two brothers, they never compromised in making the high quality shoes, and they never used they never used the product of low quality. They always prepared the shoe which was of high quality, and they were not at all concerned about the market that was going at very rapid pace. They continued with their own pace. The pace at which they started working, they continued with that pace only. Though they were not very wealthy, they did not earn throughout their life in this trade of shoemaking. They were not able to earn a lot. They could earn only that much that it was hand to mouth to them. Whatever they earned, they ate, and whatever they earned, they had invested it in their business. Then also, they were not at all greedy to get more. They never compromised with the quality. They never compromised with the perfection. They always strive to achieve perfection in the art of shoemaking. And one humble gentleman who used to order shoe from them has narrated the story as to how we experienced the events. Let us read the original text and find out what actually happens in the story. Now children, before starting the story, as I have already told you many times, that the box that has been provided before every story, the square or the rectangular box, we should read whatever is written inside the box. It is very helpful. It helps us in answer formation. It helps us in answering the question, that are asked in the exams, and it gives us a fair bit of idea about the style of writing of the author as well. Now let us start. Open your books to page number 24. John Galsworthy is the author of this story. Was born on 14th August 1867 in Kingston Hill, Surrey, England, and died on January 31, 1933 in Grove Lodge, Hampstead. Was an English novelist and playwright, winner of the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1932. He came from a newly rich upper class commercial family. Newly rich means they were not rich, their forefathers were not rich, they had become rich. Newly means few generations back only they had become rich. Trained as lawyer, he switched to writing as soon as his father died. His works mainly deal with social class system prevalent at that time, concentrating specially on the upper middle class to which his own family belonged. Although he treated his characters sympathetically, he highlighted their narrow-minded snobbishness and suffocating moral values, projecting their acquisite tendencies as morally wrong. At the same time, he also campaigned for a variety of causes, such as women's rights and animal protection, through his writings. All these issues, plus many more related to the hardships faced by people in changing time, are found to be in the short stories as well. John Galsworthy is best remembered for his trilogy, The Forsyth Saga, chronicling the life of three generations in an upper middle class family, similar to his own. The Skin Game and Loyalties are the two of his best plays. His play Justice led to prison reforms. When in 1917 he was offered a knighthood, he rejected it, saying writing was an author's greatest reward. However, he later accepted the Order of Merit and also the Nobel Prize. In the narrative story Quality, published in 1912, Galsworthy poses the issue of hardships that true artists have to face in a shallow, money-mad world that attaches little importance to the ideas of quality and excellence. Now here itself we have come across the fact that the story deals with the idea of perfection and the race in which we are running these days. That is, we are always striving for more and more, we are not satisfied, and this world is mad for money, and we are no more concerned with quality. Rather, we are concerned with quantity. If we have a small portion of money, then, and if we are able to live happily in that amount, we don't feel satisfied. We always want more and more. That is what the story is going to deal with, the madding crowd. Now, page number 25, the original story, John Galsworthy. I knew him from the days of my extreme youth, because he was my father. He made my father's boots. Inhabiting with his elder brother two little shops let into one, a small by street now no more, but then most fashionably placed in the West End. Now the narrator is saying that he knew the man about whom he is going to describe since his childhood, because that was the man who used to prepare shoe for his father, and the person who used to prepare shoe, who used to make shoe, he was the owner of a shop, and there were two shops linked together, and from outside it gave the appearance as if there were two shops, and as soon as we entered inside the shop, we came across the fact that it was only one shop. The tenement had a quiet distinction. There was no sign upon its face that he made for any of the royal family, merely his own German names of Gessler brother, and in the window a few pair of boots. Now the tenement means the outside the shop there was no hoarding at all, and there was no symbol indicating that these shoemakers, they even prepared shoe of one of the highest quality, apart from the few pieces that were put in the display in the showcase. I remember that it always troubled me to account for those unwearing boots in the window, for he made only what was ordered. Unwearing means the boots, the pieces of that were put to display, they were not very similar to each other, rather they were very much different, and that's why the narrator is saying that he found it difficult to understand why they were so much similar. And then he's saying it was because of the fact that these two the shoemaker, he used to prepare shoes only on orders. Whatever order he received, he used to prepare those shoes only, and he did not prepare anything in bulk. Reaching nothing, for he made only what was ordered, reaching nothing down. It seemed so inconceivable that what he made could never have failed to fit. Now, he made whatever was given to him, whatever size, whatever design was given to him, he made it in such an exact manner that it never happened that whatever he produced did not fit properly to the person who wore it. Had he bought them to put there, that too seemed inconceivable. He would never have tolerated in his house leather on which he had worked for not worked himself. Now he's saying, and now the narrator is saying, that this man never compromised with the quality of leather. The quality that he used for himself, he always produced that quality for the customers as well. Besides, they were too beautiful. The pair of pumps, so expressively slim, the patent leathers with cloth tops making water come into one's mouth, the tall brown riding boots with marvelous sooty glow as if, though new, they had been worn 100 years. Those pairs could only have been made by one who saw before him the soul of boot. The soul of boot means the heart of boot. Now the pieces that were in display, they were something very marvelous. And the narrator is saying that it was only these brothers, it was only this shoemaker who could make this. And because he had put his soul into the boot, put his soul into what he was trying to deliver, what he was trying to give, he made it wholeheartedly. That's why he was able to give it to persons. So truly were they prototypes incarnating the very spirit of all foot care. Prototypes incarnating means they were reflective of all the protection that a foot this shoemaker prepared. It was a reflection of the full protective foot gear that a person can prepare. These thoughts, of course, came to me later, though even when I was promoted to him at the age of perhaps 14, some inkling haunted me of the dignity of himself and brother. For to make boots, such boots as he made, seemed to me then, and still seems to me, mysterious and wonderful. Now, previously when he was a child, he used to visit this shoemaker, as a small child with his father, who used to get his shoe prepared from there. But then he himself started ordering the shoe from this shop at the age of 14 around. And then he's saying that what kept him more inclined, more interested in the shop was the dignity with which the man and his brother, they ran the shop. And because he is saying, to make boots, such boots as he made, seemed to me then and still seems to me mysterious and wonderful, because they prepared the shoes of highest quality, and it was beyond imagination that how can a person make such perfect pair of shoes. That is why he is saying that these two brothers, and that too they made it with dignity and honor. They did not do copy paste work that is being done today. In today's world, they did their work with full honor and dignity. Now children, today I am now this session, this video I am ending over here. Stay tuned for the next video on the same story. Have a nice day. Goodbye children.